So this, so we've been talking about the fruits of the Spirit, which are one of the most important things there is. Because this is how people can actually see the difference between children of God and the world. If you say you're a Christian, but you do not show any fruits of the Spirit, what does it mean?
Yeah.
It says here in Galatians 5:22, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. Well, so far that's true. Hope it stays that way. We're going to talk about the peace of the Lord. So I got a question for you. How many times has the Lord failed you? Yes, zero. So then I got a question. If the Lord has never failed you, why are you worried he's going to do it? Why are you worried he's going to fail you now? We have peace when we have our full confidence in the Lord. We have faith that he will continue to do what he's always done. You know that song, He'll Do It Again? There's a reason for that song, because he will do it again. Amen? The reason we lack peace is because we have fear. Fear is the opposite of faith. See, fear is a strong belief that the absolute worst is going to happen in the future. Faith is the strong belief that the very best is going to happen in the future. The future's unknown. I know not what the future holds. Anyone know what the rest of that song says? But I know who holds the future. When fear is winning, we are panicking. We're scared to death about what's going to happen. We just think the worst thing possible is going to happen. We create more problems in our mind than even could happen. You know? But when faith is winning, we can have peace. Because we believe that the God that has brought us through yesterday, day before that, it's going to keep on bringing us through. Psalm 27:1 says this, the Lord is my light and my salvation. And then asks the question, whom shall I fear? When the Lord is on your side, who do you have to be afraid of? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? See, we're afraid when we think that we have to be the strength of our life. If I think that I'm the only one that can help me. Because, you know, I failed. I'm not all powerful. I'm not all knowing. I'm not always right. My plans don't always succeed. And so if I'm just counting on me, I do have a reason to fear. But I don't have to just count on me. I've got the Lord on my side. Psalm 61 says, hear my cry, O God, attend to my prayer. From the end of the earth, I will cry to you. See, this is what we do. What we're supposed to do, not rely on ourselves, not be worried because we know that we can mess up. We look to the Lord. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. We need to remember how much higher our God is than we are. We don't need to be worried when we know it's not up to us. My success is not totally dependent on me. I've got God. For you have been a shelter for me, a strong tower from the enemy. I can say in your life that God has been a shelter for you. Has he been a strong tower for you? So, why would you be worried that he's going to stop being a shelter for you? That he'll stop being a strong tower? I might not always be consistent, but you know what? God is. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. We don't have to worry that he's suddenly going to stop. God has brought us through. We just need to place our faith in him, and then we can have peace. Because we truly know that he will bring us through, whatever it is. I will abide in your tabernacle forever. I will trust in the shelter of your wings. Selah, that means think about it. And that's what we need to do, is think about it. We can trust in the shelter of God's wings. I know. We're going to always have problems. We're always going to have financial problems. We're going to have physical problems, health problems. Our loved ones might have health problems, those kind of problems. We might lose something. We might have any other kind of problems, legal problems, emotional problems. But we need to trust. We need to trust in God. Because he actually cares for us. I know it is amazing to think that the great big creator of the universe cares for little old me. When we do fear, that's what we need to remember. We give it to the Lord, the one who's already proven himself. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, "For God has not given us the spirit of fear, but power and love and of sound mind." So if God isn't the one who gave us this fear that we sometimes have, where'd it come from? Satan and ourselves, that's it. Either way, living in fear is not what God intends for us. It's not, and we don't have a reason to fear, because the Lord is with us. John 16:33, Jesus said, "These things have I spoken to you, that in me you may have what?
Peace.
In the world, you will have tribulation. Like I said, there are always going to be problems. Whether it's your car failing, whether it's your finances failing, whether it's your health failing, there is always going to be problems. But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." And that is a key thing. We need to be able to, even when we are going through whatever tribulation we face, whenever we're going through it, we need to trust in God enough that we can be of good cheer. If we have the peace of the Lord, then we know that God's going to take care of it, because God is always taking care of us. We need to have that confidence. We have a reason to have that confidence. We're not having confidence. I bought a lottery ticket and I'm confident it's going to win. That's a very,
false confidence.
Yeah, a chance of 1 in 10 billion, you know. But when you're putting your trust in God, what are your odds? 100%. He's already overcome the world. Psalm 107:29 says this: "He calms the storm so its waves are still." You know, whether you're talking about an actual regular storm or the storms of life when everything overwhelms us. I find this to be very interesting, because there was a point when this was fulfilled. Anyone remember when Jesus did that?
Yeah. He was walking on the water.
Yeah. Yeah, Jesus. Yeah, why? Yeah, it makes you wonder why they were so surprised when he was able to calm the storm. Mark 4:35. "On the same day when evening had come, he," that's Jesus, "said to them, 'Let us cross over to the other side.' Now when they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat as he was. And other little boats were also with him. And great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so it was already filling. Would you like to be on that boat ride? Not yet. But when you get to the end, you might have wanted to be there and see it, but no. Now, I don't have a particular problem with being on boats, but if it was doing that, if it was doing that, I don't think I'd want to be on it. But Jesus, you know what he's doing? He's asleep in the stern, asleep on a pillow. I mean, talk about calm, you know. You know, is God terribly worried that he won't be able to solve your problem? Is he pacing the floors, pulling out his hair, trying to figure out, how am I going to bring Jeff through this? No. And they awoke him and said to him, Teacher, do you not care that we're perishing? So, what does he do? What does he do when they say, do you even care? I mean, how many have felt that way, actually? Yeah. You know, we can laugh about this. We know how the story ends. But what's happening in our life is totally different. Where it's, oh, no. God, don't you even care about me? I have to go through this and this. Why are you making me go through all this? Because we let fear take over. That is a very big problem with people, with all of us. We see things. We see a bill we don't know how we're going to pay. We see a car trouble. We don't know how we're going to pay for that. We have a medical condition. We don't know how it's going to be taken care of. You know, the worst that can happen to you is you go to heaven. But that's not how we think, is it? We just think, oh no, nobody knows all the trouble I've seen. Then he arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, Peace, be still. And the wind ceased and there was a great calm. You know, they wake him up, they're scared to death. He just walks up there and just, peace, be still. And all of a sudden, everything's fine. You know, sometimes God will wait until it looks like you're going under. Because he wants to see if you'll trust him. If we never had to go through a trial, how would we learn to trust God? You know, God wants our faith. And one of the best ways to express that faith is by having peace in the midst of your storm. We just trust him. We know he's going to bring us through, so we're not panicked. But he said to them, Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? I wonder if God's ever said that to me. I wonder if God's ever said that to you. Why are we so fearful? You know, one of my favorite songs about this is, Why do I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? You know, we know that his eye is on the sparrow and he's watching us. And they feared exceedingly and said to one another, Who can this be that even the wind and the sea obey him? Well, there was a clue that they had in their Bible. I know they didn't have access to carry a Bible home, but I'm sure they had heard that psalm that said exactly who it is. Yeah. You know, and that's what we need to remember. Who it is we're dealing with. We're dealing with God Almighty. You can trust in your friends or your family, but they can only do so much. There are things that are beyond their ability to help. But what's beyond God's ability?
nothing. You know, we go through all kinds of storms. Sometimes financial, sometimes illness, sometimes losing loved ones. But if we'll let him, God can and will give us peace to go through it. And there's a song that says, sometimes he calms a storm, and sometimes he calms his child. And regardless of which is it is that's happening in your life, you need to put your trust in him. Let him give you the peace that passes understanding. That's what we need to do. Philippians 4:6 says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. So, how easy is it to read those first four words?
Easy to read, but
yes. Hard to practice. Worst thing is when you actually are practicing this, there's some people who will say that you're just being silly, not being worried. Just saying, oh, I trust God. Oh, you need to grow up. You need to take it more seriously. Yeah, what I do is I try to take God seriously. If you take God seriously, then what is it? It's if God was this whole building, and I am worried about, I'm worried to death about this pen. God's not more powerful than the pen. I see it's right in front of me. There's nothing can beat this pen. It's huge. But if you actually put it in perspective against God, it's nothing. Like I said, God is not... He's not terrified and worried that he's not going to come up with the solution to our problems. But for us, we're not supposed to be worried about it. We're not supposed to be anxious for it. What are we supposed to do? Pray. Pray. And with what? Yes, with thanksgiving. It's been mentioned earlier in this service. The more when you start thanking God for what he's done, the more your confidence comes, grows, and you realize that God has done this, this. He's brought you through this and this. And why should you be worried? We're thankful. We're praying. Let our requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. I find it interesting that we can have a peace that passes all understanding, a joy unspeakable and full of glory, a love that never fails. Leave the others alone because we'll talk about them later. But you know, these fruits of the Spirit, they're just simple words, love, joy, peace. But what we get from God is a lot more, so much more than what you might think, than what you might think in our human understandings. It's not, the peace that God gives us is not like the peace that we might have in ourselves if we're taking a test we know we studied for. The peace that God gives us is beyond understanding. It's a peace that passes all understanding, a peace that we can't really describe. I talk about peace, but the peace of the Lord is something that is beyond anything we can understand. And it guards our hearts and minds. That peace is going to guard you. When you don't have the peace of the Lord, and you see your situation, what's happening in your heart and mind? Going a million miles per hour, panicking, coming up with all kinds of stupid solutions, and you'll probably pick the very stupidest of them. That is what happens. The peace, that is what happens when we don't have God's peace guarding us. It's very important, vital. And when the world sees that we have the peace of God, they can see that God is making a difference in us. And to finish a few more verses in that passage. Finally, brethren, this is a good way to have peace, by the way. What you're thinking about, what you're letting inside your head, has a lot to do with it. Whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there's any virtue, if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. You know, garbage in, garbage out. Yeah. You know, if we're thinking about the goodness of the Lord, we're a lot less likely to be panicked. A lot more likely to have confidence and trust in Him. The things which you learned and received and heard and saw in me, Paul says, these do, and what? Peace of God, the God of peace will be with you. If we give our troubles to Jesus, confident that He will give you His peace, that will guard your heart against panicking and doing something stupid, we don't need to concentrate on all the bad. And there's always going to be bad. There's never going to be a day in your life when you can't think of something to worry about. There's never going to be a situation where there's nothing to worry about in this life. New Jerusalem, that'll be different, but not in this life. There's always going to be something wrong. We don't need to concentrate on all that bad. It will just give us panic attacks. Peter said, therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that He may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon Him, for He cares for you. That literally means is throwing all your anxiety onto Jesus. You just toss it, throw it, because it matters to Him. I know it is hard to imagine that a great big God, creator of the universe, cares, but He does. You matter to Him. You matter to God. You matter to God. When we cast our cares on Jesus, let Him worry about it, and He ain't going to worry. But we just let Him take care of it. We can have the peace of God. So Matthew said, Jesus said in Matthew 6:25, therefore I say to you, do not worry about your life. Another easy thing to say, easy thing, but we do. We see problems, we don't know how we're going to solve them, we tend to worry. And that's not what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to throw our cares on Jesus. So do not worry about your life, what you will eat, what you will drink, nor about your body, what you'll put on. Is not life more than food? And the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air, for they neither sow nor reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? Which does God care more about, you or a sparrow? Which of you, by worrying, can add one cubit to his stature? So if I worry and worry and worry, am I going to be this tall? If I just decide I want to, I just worry, worry, worry. Well, you might be able to add an ulcer to yourself. You might be able to add high blood pressure to yourself. But that's not going to help your problems, is it? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, Jesus was very specific when He said, add one. You can slightly get shorter as you get older, But once you're done with your regular growing up, that's the highest you'll ever be. How much good can you do by worrying and worrying and worrying? Best you can do is make it worse. Just make it worse. So why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. And yet I say to you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. And you can only imagine how Solomon, basically the richest guy in the world during his time. I know he didn't even have a bathroom, but he had gold and silver and all this stuff. But he wasn't arrayed like a field of lilies. Now if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is, and tomorrow is thrown in the oven, will he not much more clothe you? Or you of little faith? And that's what we need to remember when we're worrying, is we're having a problem with our faith. If you find that you are worrying, what you need to do is work on your faith. The way to work on that is thinking about all God has brought us through. You think about all he has done and what he has promised. If you start thinking about listing your blessings instead of your problems, when you count your blessings, all of a sudden your fears, your worries can start to drift away as your confidence in God grows. Therefore, do not worry, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For after all these things, the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you have need, that you need all these things, you know. This kind of stuff, the world has problems too. And when they see that you're worried about the same stuff they are, what difference does God make in your life? But we know that our Creator knows everything we need. We do not have any need that God doesn't know about. And when God knows our need, He's going to provide, isn't He? But seek first. This was a Bible verse when I was just in Sunday school as a kid. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And all these things, what Jesus was just talking about, shall be added to you. You've got to have a priority. Our priority isn't worrying and going, driving ourselves crazy, scared to death about how our needs are going to be met. Our priority is the kingdom of God. Living for God, studying His word, sharing His word. All these things will be added to us. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. And one of my favorite sentences in the whole Bible: sufficient for the day is its own trouble. How many of us have tried to come up with trouble for tomorrow? You know, what if this happens? What if that happens? We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, but we know who holds tomorrow. And we've got enough to deal with to know what we need to do. Just do what you have to do and trust God to make it work. Yeah, so I want to just play a song that I've already mentioned here. Show a video of a song that is Why Should I Feel Discouraged? OK. because we can trust in God.
And you know what? Speaking of encouragement, there is a song that I just learned not too long ago. Hadn't really listened to the words. But what an encouragement it has been to me for a long time now. And I know it has been to many of you. Maybe when we get to the chorus, you might even want to sing along. Why should I feel discouraged? I know that song. And why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home when Jesus is my portion, my constant friend? For his eye is on each and every sparrow, so I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know. Some of you singing already. Go ahead. I sing because I'm happy, and I sing because I'm free. For his eyes on the sparrow, and I know. And let not your heart be troubled, for his tender words I hear, and resting on his goodness, I lose the doubts and the fears. I draw thee closer to me. You know what? And from care he sets me free. For his eye is on each and every sparrow, so I know he watches me. His eye
give him a clap offering, won't you?
So to sum it up, instead of looking at how big our problems are, what we need to be looking at is how big our God is, that He cares about every one of us. We can throw all our anxieties, all our cares on Him. And when we do, we can have the peace that passes all understanding. Lord Jesus, we thank You so much for that peace that You have promised us, that You have freely available to us. We thank You that we can put all our faith in You, all our faith, all our confidence in You. We know You care for us, and we know that You can bring us through anything, no matter what the circumstance. There is nothing that You can't bring us through. Lord, we ask You to help us to apply this, to truly trust You, to have the faith that You deserve, the confidence in You that You deserve, that You have earned, because You have always been there for us in the past. Help us to remember that and trust You completely, 100%, with our future. In Jesus' name, amen.
We can have peace because Jesus leads us, amen?
Amen.
We don't have to worry about where we're going because Jesus will lead us through. He leadeth me, O blessed thought, O woods with heavenly comfort fraught. Whate'er I do, where'er I be, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, He leadeth me, by His own hand He leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by His hand He leadeth me. Sometimes mid scenes of deepest gloom, sometimes where Eden's bowers bloom, by water still or troubled sea, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, He leadeth me, by His own hand He leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by His hand He leadeth me. Lord, I would clasp Thy hand in mine, nor ever murmur nor repine. Content, whatever lot I see, since 'tis Thy hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, He leadeth me, by His own hand He leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by His hand He leadeth me. And when my task on earth is done, when by Thy grace the victory's won, in death's cold wave I will not flee, since God through Jordan leadeth me. He leadeth me, He leadeth me, by His own hand He leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by His hand He leadeth me. Hope and pray that we're willing to take God's hand and let Him lead us, not worry about where He's taking us, to be content where He's taking us, because He knows tomorrow, and He knows what's best. Amen. Hello, I'm Pastor Larry Evans, and you've been watching a New Life Church video. If it has been a blessing, please like, share, subscribe, and comment on it. We'd love to hear from you. Our website is www.newlifenwin.org and has our schedule as well as more information about us. God bless.